So in leading up to the 2016 presidential election, I worked at Miami University for 7 years before coming to Ohio State. So Miami University of Ohio, which is in Oxford, Ohio, a relatively small rural town in southwestern Ohio. And there's because of the size of Miami and the rural nature of getting there, there's not very many ways to get to Oxford, Ohio. You're not driving through Oxford, Ohio, for example, like you're going there as your destination. About 10 minutes away from campus on my drives, I often passed by this house that had a Trump sign. And I noticed that as we got closer and closer to the election, the size of this sign grew in size, and more of them were also on this person's front lawn. And so, you know, I would get to campus. This is about 3 or 4 days a week. I would get to campus, and I just realized it was about 8:30 a.m. when I would arrive on campus, and I couldn't pinpoint. Like, I just felt exhausted. Like, I had gotten good enough sleep the night before. I had eaten a good breakfast, and I just felt tired when I got to campus and just really on edge. And I couldn't, it took me a number of weeks to figure out what was happening. In the span of this happening, I was doing some work and I came across this term called racial battle fatigue. I was reading an article by William Smith, who has written extensively about this concept. And in that moment, I was like, oh my gosh, like this name, racial battle fatigue, this term, that describes what I was feeling when I got to campus. Like, I was feeling exhausted and fatigued from seeing this Trump sign, from like the racism that I was navigating in my body. And it's sort of like, now that I've talked about this concept with people, once you get language for something that you're feeling, it's very powerful to be able to name it and identify it. Mm-hmm. And so simply put, this concept of racial battle fatigue, it describes the exhaustion that people of color feel from repeated racism. And it's not just that folks of color are tired. Yes, we're exhausted, we're tired as hell, but it actually has these negative physiological, psychological, and emotional consequences on our health and well-being. So for example, psychologically, folks who are experiencing racial battle fatigue often experience frustration, shock, apathy, anger. Physiologically, we also experience headaches, grinding of teeth, shortness of breath. We might also have trouble sleeping. And then emotionally and behaviorally, loss of appetite, increased use of alcohol and drugs as a coping mechanism, and then poor school and job performance. And so when I got to Miami University to teach this, to teach my classes, often the classes I've taught historically have been courses that are centered on issues of equity, diversity, and social justice. You know, courses that bring up a lot of emotions, in particular for students with dominant identities who are navigating their privilege for the first time in many cases, right? And so those classes are taxing in their own ways. And we know historically that faculty of color who teach those courses often receive lower teaching evaluations from students, right? Because they're blaming the faculty member for making them feel these negative emotions, right? Mm-hmm. And so for me, it's like, if I'm already exhausted and experiencing racial battle fatigue at 9 a.m., and then I'm supposed to teach a class at 9:30 on the very topics around equity and inclusion, how am I supposed to perform at my best in these courses? And so that notion of poor school and job performance, I think is really powerful because it helps understand that it's not just folks of color, or we're not whining, we're not being overly sensitive, like the things that white folks often accuse us of being when we name that we're experiencing racism, but it's that this is actually having an impact on our bodies. And so to me, that's another way to think about it. Another way I'll describe it is, I think of the notion of like paper cuts, right? And so if you get one paper cut at 7 o'clock in the morning, it's not really that noticeable. You can go throughout your day. It might sting a little bit if you wash your hands, right? But then say it's like 9:30, you get another paper cut, you're gonna notice it a little bit more. And then by 4 o'clock, if you have like say 7, 8, 9 paper cuts, like now it's a wound, like you notice that constantly. And it goes to that point Cirleen was raising about how it's cumulative, right? It's the cumulative notion of all of these little, quote unquote, little acts of violence, of trauma that accumulate over time that then lead to this racial exhaustion. And then we're supposed to then perform our duties. We're supposed to, for students of color, they're supposed to show up for class, engage in research, engage in writing, as if like nothing has happened, right? When meanwhile, we're exposed to Black and Brown violence all over the place. Like Black death is being reported, it's shared over social media, right? And so this has a traumatizing effect on people's bodies. And so for me, I think when we talk about racial battle fatigue, it's really important to understand that it's the exhaustion that's important. But secondly, it's that it's actually impacting our bodies, again, psychologically, physiologically, and emotionally. So I just wanted to name that because again, it helps, I think, understand, to use Cirleen's word, the insidiousness of this racism that's occurring to people of color.